Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Tending the Heart of Virtue: How Classic Stories Awaken a Child's Moral Imagination, Second Edition, by Vigen Guroian, narrated by Daniel Thomas May. Preface to Second Expanded Edition. More than 25 years have passed since I wrote Tending the Heart of Virtue. Over these years, the book has taken me many places to deliver dozens of lectures and to lead many seminars and workshops with teachers, college students, and parents. Along the way, some have asked me if I would consider writing another book of its kind, or perhaps do an expanded second edition of Tending the Heart. My ideas about what stories and subjects might be included in a new book or a second edition have gone through many iterations, and what I have settled upon hardly begins to reflect all the possibilities that I have contemplated along the way. For this second edition, I have recast the introduction because, with the passage of time, some of my speech in it is anachronistic. For example, my son, Rafi, and daughter, Victoria, are now adults with children of their own. When I was writing Tending the Heart, there was much discussion about how to build moral character, teach values, and instill the virtues in children. I wrestled with some of these currents of opinion in Chapter 1. The climate is a little different now, and the debate has evolved. Nonetheless, the fundamental issues are the same, so I see no compelling reason to rewrite that chapter. I have limited myself to minor editing and an expansion of my discussion of the moral imagination. As to the remainder of the chapters in the first edition, I have made mainly stylistic revisions. Last, the conclusion, which serves as a bibliographical essay, has been expanded to include the new topics raised in the added chapters. Provoked by a trend in the publishing industry to produce bowdlerized versions of the fairy tales and new tellings bent to the latest ideology or social movement, Charles Dickens in 1853 issued an impassioned defense of fairy tales, titled Frauds on the Fairies. He urged that in a utilitarian age of all other times, it is a matter of grave importance that fairy tales should be respected. Indeed, he could not imagine the survival of English culture itself were these stories to be altered according to the latest fashion, for then the original stories would soon be forgotten and disappear. Forbearance, courtesy, consideration for the poor and aged, kind treatment of animals, love of nature, abhorrence of tyranny and brute force, all of these things and more are nourished in a child's heart by this powerful aid of the fairy tale, he argued. Were Dickens alive today, I do not doubt that he would protest the persistent bowdlerization, emasculation, and revision of the classic fairy tales. Beware especially when the book you are looking at advertises the contents as a retelling. It might have pretty pictures, but leave out important details in the story or even alter the narrative significantly. Often religious language is expunged. Beware in particular of Disney editions. None are faithful to the original. This state of affairs concerns parents and teachers I have met over the years, and I am glad that Tending the Heart has encouraged and emboldened them to ask critical questions about the integrity of the texts that are put before them in bookstores, in schools, in libraries, and on the internet. For practical reasons, I have decided not to write an entirely new book. Instead, I want to give Tending the Heart a new lease on life, especially within the worlds of homeschooling and classical schooling, which have expanded exponentially since the first edition. I have also listened to persons who have asked for more reflection on the classic stories. Thus, there are three new chapters in the book. The Triumph of Beauty, Chapter 7, is the first edition. In it, I return to Hans Christian Andersen. The Nightingale and The Ugly Duckling are two of Andersen's best stories. The Nightingale has been described as a manifesto on art and beauty in fairy tale form. I agree. More important, however, The Nightingale is a stunning parable about how beauty can transform our lives. The Ugly Duckling might come as a surprise under the heading of beauty. It has been mercilessly bowdlerized and recast in order to drive home the mistaken notion that, above all else, the story is about bullying or being an underdog. This is wrong. The Ugly Duckling is about how a love of beauty can change one's life. Though I did not include any of Grimm's fairy tales in Tending the Heart, I did not intentionally omit the Grimms. The best of their stories are literary masterpieces. Over the years, I have often spoken on stories such as Cinderella, Hansel and Gretel, and Snow White. Yet I am limited by topic and by what might reasonably be added to the book without making it cumbersome. I have included in this edition just one story by the Grimm brothers, Cinderella. Chapter 8, The Goodness of Goodness, pairs Cinderella with John Ruskin's The King of the Golden River. Ruskin's tale is a gem of Victorian storytelling, but sadly it has fallen out of the canon. The story's protagonist is the youngest of three brothers, whose name is Gluck, German for luck. Gluck is a male Cinderella type. This resemblance is not uppermost in my mind, however. The chapter is not a comparative exercise. It is rather an exploration of the biblical and religious leitmotifs and rich symbolism that the two stories have in common, especially regarding how goodness is embodied in the two protagonists. I close the introduction with a citation from George MacDonald's The Golden Key. This is the sort of fairy tale that virtually eludes analysis. The same may be said of several other MacDonald stories. The Wise Woman is one. In Chapter 9, Obedience and the Path to Perfection, I venture, though with trepidation, an interpretation of this remarkable story. The Wise Woman was frequently on the syllabus of my college course on children's literature, often paired with Shel Silverstein's The Giving Tree. The young men and women in that course continually surprised me with their enthusiastic reception of its message on the virtue of tough love. The wise woman is not cruel, but, to the contrary, embodies a divine wisdom and practices a demanding love that beckons us to keep on the difficult path to goodness and perfection. While my undergraduates were divided over whether Silverstein's The Giving Tree is a good or bad story, most agreed The Wise Woman is a good story. A final word. In the art of writing literary essays, once called belles lettres, how something is said is almost as important as what is said. I am speaking here of the writer's voice and the tonality of it, elements that make his writing distinctive, serve as his signature, and enable the reader to identify with him in a personal way. As I was writing the new chapters for Tending the Heart, I often turned back to the original chapters. I had thought to replicate the authorial voice in them, but discovered that hard as I might try, I could not. I am, and I am not, the same writer who wrote Tending the Heart of Virtue a quarter century ago. My voice has changed, and my vocabulary has too. Nevertheless, I do not think that the difference is so great that it is unrecognizable, jars the mind, or hurts the ears. I certainly hope that this is so. My love and respect for the stories remain the same. Vigen Guroian, Culpeper, Virginia, Easter 2022. Introduction. Children are vitally concerned with distinguishing good from evil and truth from falsehood. This need to make moral distinctions is a gift, a grace that human beings are given at the start of their lives. Of course, we mustn't mistake this grace for complete innocence. Children are not pure innocents, as every new parent quickly discovers. The guile of even the smallest child can make one wonder, where did she learn that? Becoming a responsible human being is a path filled with potholes and visited constantly by temptations. Children need guidance and moral roadmaps, and they benefit immensely from the example of adults who speak truthfully and with moral strength. Our society is finding it difficult to meet these needs of children. Some well-meaning educators and parents want to drive the passion for moral clarity out of children, rather than use it to shape their character. We want children to be tolerant, and we sometimes seem to think that a too sure sense of right and wrong only produces fanatics. Perhaps we have become so resigned to flailing about in the culture's murky waters of moral compromise and ethical obscurantism that it is hard for us to imagine other possibilities for our children. I was no exception as a young parent, and I sometimes fall into similar habits as a grandparent. I find myself doing what I often criticize in others, nervously rationalizing my laziness or unwillingness to cultivate conscience and moral sense in my grandchildren. Mostly, we all fall back on the excuse that we are respecting our children's freedom by permitting them to determine right from wrong and to choose for themselves clear goals of moral living. But this is the paean of a false freedom that pays misdirected tribute to a deeply flawed notion of individual autonomy. We end up forfeiting our parental authority and failing to be mentors to our children in the moral life. This, I fear, is the actual state of things. Every parent who has read a fairy tale to a young son or daughter is familiar with what I venture to say is a universal refrain of childhood. But is he a good person or a bad one? Or is she a good fairy or an evil fairy? What stronger proof or assurance could we want that God and nature have endowed even the youngest human beings with a moral constitution that needs to be nurtured and cultivated? Yet our society embraces an anti-human trinity of utilitarianism, subjectivism, and relativism that denies the existence of a moral sense or moral law. Almost 80 years ago, C.S. Lewis, author of the popular Narnia Chronicles, diagnosed this state of affairs in his brilliant little book, The Abolition of Man. In it, Lewis discusses the forces that starve the moral imagination and replace it with moral relativism and utilitarian reason. He warned of a rising philosophy of education and child-rearing that undermines confidence in moral certitudes and substitutes the dogma that morality is relative to individual desire and cultural context. We are reaping the dreadful harvest of that trend in our day. Such is the Weltgeist that captures the minds of many modern people. And yet, even as we submit ourselves to this new morality, we continue to want and expect children to grow up to be good people. This is the tragicomedy of our situation, Lewis comments, that while we clamor for those very qualities of character and virtue in our children, we are rendering them impossible. In a sort of ghastly simplicity, we remove the organ and demand the function. We make men without chests and expect of them virtue. Perhaps it is not surprising that someone who detected such things in the culture went on to write a series of remarkable children's fantasy stories, the first and best known of these being The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, that invite modern children into a world where the old morality reigns and retains its compelling vigor. Lewis, of course, was heir to the Victorian retrieval of the fairy tale. And he followed in the footsteps of the great 19th-century inventors of fairy tales and fantasy stories, among whom we can certainly count the Grimms, Hans Christian Andersen, and George MacDonald. The Victorians brought fairy tales into the nursery because they saw in them a wisdom and a capacity to stimulate and instruct the moral imagination. In our day, we have witnessed a resurgence of this interest in the fairy tale. The renowned psychiatrist Bruno Bettelheim lent an important impetus to this movement almost 50 years ago with his publication of The Uses of Enchantment, The Meaning and Importance of Fairy Tales. It hardly requires emphasis at this moment in our history, Bettelheim wrote, that children need a moral education that teaches not through abstract ethical concepts, but through that which seems tangibly right and therefore meaningful. The child finds this kind of meaning through fairy tales. As parents raising small children in the 1980s, my wife June and I looked for guidance in choosing stories to read to our son Rafi and our daughter Victoria, as they do today raising their own children. When Rafi and Victoria were between the ages of 5 and 12, we read most of the stories I discuss in this book. Then I took these stories into the college classroom, where I taught for a quarter century a course titled Religion in Children's Literature. This all began with a conversation one evening in the fall of 1983 in the lounge of a hotel in Washington, D.C. I had arranged to meet the late writer and man of letters Russell Kirk and his wife Annette. They were in town for a lecture Russell was to give. Russell had written on occasion about children's literature and practiced on his four daughters his own exceptional talent for telling what he liked to call ghostly tales. That evening I asked him what children's stories were his favorites, and he was obliging. He mentioned to me George MacDonald's The Princess and the Goblin, Carlo Collodi's Pinocchio, a personal favorite of his, and Lewis's Narnia Chronicles. He added such favorites as John Ruskin's The King of the Golden River, Oscar Wilde's The Selfish Giant, and of course the classic tales of the Grimm brothers and Hans Christian Andersen. Most of the books and fairy tales Russell mentioned to me that evening are in this book. In writing this book, I have tried to give my listeners similar help to make the right choices. In time, as I explored further, I was surprised to discover that there were very few books written in an accessible way on children's literature for parents and teachers. I mean books that take care to discuss the content and meaning of these stories in relation to the child's understanding and the parents' and teachers' concerns about raising children to be ethical persons. Literary criticism on children's literature is still a relatively new field and has not contributed much to the audiences I have in mind. And while this is another matter that I have addressed elsewhere, much of what the critics have to say I disagree with. Much of it is social constructionist, based on a theory that all meaning is subjective, not objectively real, and changes as society changes. Or it wears the blinders of one school of thinking or ideology, whether that be Marxist, Freudian, Jungian, or feminist. One might have thought ethicists could do better. Yet ethicists, whether religious or philosophical, have not done better. There is a paucity of reflection on children as moral learners or actors. Ethicists have written very little on the virtues as taught and communicated in fairy tales and children's stories. Perhaps this is because, like so many others, ethicists too subscribe to the mistaken notion that childhood is more about socialization than moral formation. In any case, it is far safer to presume that the moral agent is an adult when discussing morality. After all, in a very real way, we adults have difficulty entering into the inner moral experience of the child. Thus, my task in this book is a rather simple one. My principal objective is to be a helpful guide through some of the most beloved fairy tales and classic and contemporary stories written for children. I have tried to be of assistance to parents and teachers who want to explore the moral and religious significance of these stories with their own children or students. By and large, I have left definitions of childhood and what actually constitutes children's literature to others. All of the stories that I discuss in this book fall one way or another into the category of fairy tale and the related modern genre of fantasy story. My experience in the classroom with persons ranging from 18 to 80 has proven to me the wisdom in C.S. Lewis's observation about the best test of a children's story. In an essay on writing children's stories, Lewis quips, "I am almost inclined to set it up as a canon that a children's story which is enjoyed only by children is a bad children's story. The good ones last. A waltz which you can only like when you are waltzing is a bad waltz." I am a theologian by trade, and so, as might be expected, I have been alert not just to moral themes, but also to the great religious questions that have been raised by some of the most popular and honored authors of children's stories. More often than not, contemporary writers and critics have avoided these religious themes or discussed them with embarrassment, if not outright antagonism. Thus, I have taken up the challenge to explore seriously some of these religious topics. Most of the chapter headings signal this interest. Themes such as love, Beauty, immortality, evil, and redemption are at the heart of many of the best fairy tales and children's stories, and these themes ought not to be overlooked or minimized. I hope this book is that much better for its serious attention to the religious and moral aspects of these stories. As I already have mentioned, this book began with my own children. That is to say that it came to be in large measure because, like other parents, I thought it was important to read stories to my children and to select the right ones. I searched for stories that would enrich their imagination and provide them with some memories that might positively influence their character and conduct throughout the whole of their lives. I have continued this practice with my grandchildren, to whom I have dedicated this edition. I believe that my children became better readers and writers, even better speakers, because we spent special time together reading the fairy tales of the Grimm brothers and George MacDonald, or the Märchen and humorous tales from the Middle East and Armenia that my maternal grandmother told me when I was a child. I think that my son's willingness to go to a remote village in Armenia in the summer of 1996 to complete reconstruction of an ancient church toppled by the catastrophic earthquake of December 1988 was helped by the fact that I had told him my grandmother's stories. In his application to colleges, I discovered a short essay that Rafi wrote in answer to the question about which books of his childhood meant the most to him. He responded that C.S. Lewis's Narnia Chronicles were the most memorable because they left him standards to live by. And in his high school senior English course, Rafi decided to read all of the Narnia books again and to write a final paper on Lewis's use of the elements of classical epic in the stories. As for Victoria, there happened a wonderful confluence of our early reading with her passion for ballet. She learned through dance how much the fairy tale genre has influenced music and art. Over the years, she has danced to the music of such musical compositions as The Nutcracker, Swan Lake, and the ballet version of Alice in Wonderland. I think that the great fairy stories lend themselves naturally to dance and dramatic enactment. When Victoria was in fourth grade, I approached her English teacher with the idea of bringing my undergraduate seminar on children's literature into her classroom. We decided that our common reading would be Pinocchio, and that late in the spring session, my students and I would meet with her fourth graders at St. Paul's School in Brooklandville, Maryland, for conversation and to share poster drawings depicting scenes from the story. We would conclude by breaking off into smaller groups to rehearse dramatic enactments of these scenes or episodes, and then gather together to perform these skits for each other. Even more than a quarter century later, I can recollect vividly the reaction of my Loyola College students to this experience. They were struck by how much detail the fourth graders remembered, and by the sophisticated lessons they drew from what they read. In an essay titled Children and Literature, the renowned child psychiatrist Robert Coles has commented, "The truth is that many of us, certainly many in my field of child psychology, don't give enough credit to the natural, normal, everyday development of narrative interest, narrative sense, narrative response, narrative competence in boys and girls." My college students made this very discovery for themselves. They also confessed with open embarrassment that the fourth graders had grasped better than they much of the meaning of the story. For example, the fourth graders seemed to recognize from personal knowledge the nature and source of Pinocchio's temptations and backslidings, and were much less prepared than they to excuse him for the behavior and decisions that got him into so much trouble and caused Geppetto such grief. The fourth graders did not yet believe, as contemporary college students are apt to do, that growing up is a straight line. 12 years of primary and secondary education, 4 years of college, and then with a degree in hand, one is well on the way to becoming a complete and successful human being. Whereas my college students admitted they sometimes got bored with the repetition of the story, the elementary school children became absorbed in that repetition. It reminded the children of their own experience of trying and failing and trying again. G.K. Chesterton observes in Lunacy and Letters, for it is a mark of the essential morality of fairyland, a thing too commonly overlooked, that happiness, like happiness anywhere else, involves an object and even a challenge. We can only admire scenery if we want to get past it. The repeated attempts and failures of Pinocchio and the challenges he faces over and over again to reunite with the object of his affection and love, Geppetto, his father and maker, made immediate sense to the fourth graders and held their attention. My college students began to suspect that maybe they had lost something in growing up, a sense of wonder and a yearning for a taste of the other that might have been better tended and retained if they had been brought up on more of what we were reading in class. Perhaps the fourth graders they had met were actually nearer than they to the wellsprings of human morality and were better served by reading Pinocchio than they had been by a required course in ethics. Repetition signified one other thing to the fourth graders, the importance of which also dawned on my college students. Chesterton comments that when we grow up, we tend to think that repetition is a sign of deadness. Like a piece of clockwork, people feel that if the universe was personal, it would vary. If the sun were alive, it would dance. To the contrary, variation in human affairs is generally brought into them not by life, but by death, by the dying down or breaking off of their strength or desire. A man varies his movements because of some slight element of failure or fatigue. Whereas repetition, far from signifying monotony and deadness, may signify delight, desire, and vitality. And this is what it seemed to mean for the children of St. Paul's school who read Pinocchio. A child kicks his legs rhythmically through excess, not absence, of life. Because children have unbounding vitality, because they are spirit fierce and free, therefore they want things repeated and unchanged. They always say, "Do it again," because there is such delight in that thing or activity. It may be, Chesterton concludes, that God makes every daisy separately, but has never got tired of making them. It may be that he has the eternal appetite of infancy, for we have sinned and grown old, and our Father is younger than we. The repetition in nature may not be a mere recurrence. It may be a theatrical encore. Perhaps we need more intergenerational learning of the sort my college class and I experienced back then at St. Paul's School. Perhaps fairy tales ought not only to take a bigger place in American childhoods, but ought to be read by college students as well. In Chapter 1, I discuss what I believe are some of the serious shortcomings of contemporary education when it comes to the moral instruction of our children and the important role that fairy tales and fantasy stories could play in this instruction. My views have been formed and confirmed by my experience with my own children, with my grandchildren, and in the classroom. The candor, honesty, and intelligence of the college students I taught for decades have added to my conviction that things must be done differently. I have also taught graduate students, parents, and teachers over the years. During the 1990s, I taught graduate-level courses at the Ecumenical Institute of Theology of St. Mary's Seminary and University in Baltimore, Maryland. I offered workshops and seminars on fairy tales and children's stories. Those experiences remain very special in my memory. The seminars were attended by public and parochial school teachers, seminarians, religious sisters, and priests and pastors. Much of my inspiration for this book grew from these workshops and seminars. While attending one of these seminars, a black pastor of an inner-city Baltimore church was moved to commence a series of sermons for adults and children that explored some of the fairy tales we read in class. He related the fairy tales to stories of the Bible and the social ethical concerns of his ministry. I recall how he in the seminar compared Beauty and the Beast with the Old Testament story of Ruth and Naomi. He compared Ruth's love for her mother-in-law Naomi and refusal to abandon her to Beauty's love and loyalty toward her father. And he went on to explain that in her marriage to Boaz, Ruth yet manages to keep her promise never to abandon Naomi. Likewise, Even as Beauty keeps her promise to the Beast and finally marries him, she reconciles this with her love for and duty toward her father. Another black minister found the resources in Hansel and Gretel useful for his work with abandoned and abused children. As he put it, "On any given day of the week, we find more than one Hansel or Gretel on a street corner downtown." An invitation. Thus stimulated by both my readings to my children and my classroom experiences, I wrote this book in its first edition and now in an expanded form in this second edition. Over the years, I have listened very closely to the non-experts, my children, my grandchildren, and my students at Loyola and later at the University of Virginia. And I have tried my very best to draw on what I have learned from my children and my students in writing this book, from their fresh encounters with the stories I discuss. Frankly, they have taught me much more than the so-called experts. Also, I have striven to assist parents and teachers in finding norms and standards in these stories that they might not have seen on their own. I hope this book gives them confidence they might otherwise not have had in presenting these stories to children. But I also have wanted not to spoil the pleasure of reading these stories for either the first or the tenth time. The deep truths of a good story, especially fairy tales, cannot be revealed through discursive analysis alone, otherwise why tell the story? Rather, these truths must be experienced through the story itself and savored in the immediacy of the moment that unfolds with the impending danger of the quest or the joy of reunion with the beloved. In George MacDonald's haunting tale, The Golden Key, the young heroine of the story encounters the old man of the earth. "Then the old man of the earth stooped over the floor of the cave, raised a huge stone from it, and left it leaning. It disclosed a great hole that went plumb down.
'That is the way,' he said."
"But there are no stairs."
"You must throw yourself in. There is no other way."
This is also the way with fairy tales. May your own experience with this book be a beginning and not an end, not a closure but an invitation to unceasing explorations of the imagination. And may our children be the final beneficiaries. 1. Awakening the Moral Imagination. When Mendel was already the far-famed and much-hated rabbi of Kotzka, he once returned to the little town in which he was born. There he visited the teacher who taught him his alphabet when he was a child and read the 5 books of Moses with him. But he did not go to see the teacher who had given him further instruction, and at a chance meeting the man asked his former pupil whether he had any cause to be ashamed of his teacher. Mendel replied, "You taught me things that can be refuted, for according to one interpretation they can mean this, according to another that. But my first teacher taught me true teachings which cannot be refuted, and they have remained with me as such. That is why I owe him special reverence." Martin Buber, Tales of the Hasidim. Flannery O'Connor, that marvelously gifted American writer of the past century, spoke a simple though profound truth when she said that a story is a way to say something that can't be said any other way. You tell a story because a statement would be inadequate. The great fairy tales and fantasy stories communicate the meaning of morality through vivid depictions of the struggle between good and evil, where characters must make difficult choices between right and wrong, or heroes and villains contest the very fate of imaginary worlds. Not didacticism, but rather the narrative, the dramatic action, makes the fairy tales meaningful. Narrative supplies the imagination with important symbolic information about the shape of our world and appropriate responses to its inhabitants. The contemporary moral philosopher Alistair MacIntyre sums this up eloquently. It is through hearing about wicked stepmothers, lost children, good but misguided kings, wolves that suckle twin boys, youngest sons who receive no inheritance but must make their own way in the world, and eldest sons who waste their inheritance, that children learn or mislearn both what a child and what a parent is, what the cast of characters may be in the drama into which they have been born, and what the ways of the world are. Deprive children of stories, and you leave them unscripted, anxious stutterers in their actions as in their words. G.K. Chesterton muses about the wisdom and ethics of the fairy tale. He writes, "I am concerned with a certain way of looking at life, which was created in me by the fairy tales, but has since been meekly ratified by mere facts. This way of looking at life that Chesterton identifies, I in this book call the moral imagination." This is illustrated when he continues, "We can say why we take liberty from a man who takes liberties, but we cannot say why an egg can turn into a chicken any more than we can say why a bear could turn into a fairy prince. As ideas, the egg and the chicken are further from each other than the bear and the prince, for no egg itself suggests a chicken, whereas some princes do suggest bears. Likewise, we may say that values are set by the free market or by the state, and measure what we are up against and how we should trade our wares or parlay our talents. Yet we cannot know, except within the context of the entire story, that what initially seemed to be the enlightened discernment of a character was actually a stupid cleverness, courage a stupid bravado, or disloyalty creative fidelity to a greater good." The Virtues and Moral Character. Moral living is about being responsive and responsible toward other people. And virtues are those traits of character that enable persons to use their freedom in morally responsible ways. The mere ability, however, to use moral principles to justify one's actions does not make a virtuous person. The brilliant 20th century Jewish philosopher Martin Buber tells the story of how he fell into the fatal mistake of giving instruction in ethics by presenting ethics as formal rules and principles. Buber discovered that very little of this kind of education gets transformed into character-building substance. In his little gem of moral and educational philosophy, an essay appropriately entitled "The Education of Character," Buber recalls, "I try to explain to my pupils that envy is despicable, and at once I feel the secret resistance of those who are poorer than their comrades. I try to explain that it is wicked to bully the weak, and at once I see a suppressed smile on the lips of the strong. I try to explain that lying destroys life, and something frightful happens. The worst habitual liar of the class produces a brilliant essay on the destructive power of lying." Mere instruction in morality is not sufficient to nurture the virtues. It might even backfire, especially when the presentation is heavily exhortative and the pupil feels coerced. Instead, a compelling vision of the goodness of goodness itself needs to be presented in such a way that it is attractive and stirs the imagination. A good moral education addresses both the cognitive and affective dimensions of human nature. And stories are an irreplaceable medium for this kind of moral education, by which I mean the education of character. The Greek word for character means literally an impression. Moral character is an impression stamped upon the self. Character is defined by its orientation, consistency, and constancy. Today we often equate freedom with morality and goodness. But this is naive because freedom is transcendent and the precondition of choice itself. Depending on his or her character, an individual will be drawn toward either goodness or wickedness. Moral and immoral behavior is freedom enacted for good or ill. In the case of Beauty and the Beast. The great fairy tales and children's fantasy stories attractively depict character and virtue. In these stories, the virtues glimmer as if in a looking glass, and wickedness and deception are unmasked of their pretensions to goodness and truth. The stories make us face the unvarnished truth about ourselves and compel us to consider what kind of people we want to be. Beauty and the Beast is one of the most beloved of all the fairy tales because it contrasts goodness with badness in a way that is appealing to the imagination. It is also a story that depicts with peculiar force the mystery of virtue itself. Virtue is the magic of moral life, for it often appears in the most unexpected persons and places and with surprising results. At the beginning of the story, we learn that a very rich merchant had three daughters, all of whom were extremely handsome, especially the youngest. So she was called the Little Beauty. But nothing more is said about Beauty's physical attributes. Instead, our attention is drawn to her virtuous character. Beauty's moral goodness, her inner beauty, is contrasted with her sister's pride, vanity, and selfishness, their inner ugliness. Although Beauty's sisters are physically attractive, they had a great deal of pride because they were rich. They gave themselves ridiculous airs and laughed at their youngest sister, Beauty, because she spent the greatest part of her time in reading good books. By contrast, Beauty is charming, sweet-tempered, spoke so kindly to poor people, and truly loves her father. Because she is virtuous, Beauty is able to see in the Beast a goodness that his monstrous appearance belies. At her first supper in the monster's castle, Beauty says to the Beast, "That is true that I find you ugly, for I cannot lie, but I believe you are very good-natured." And when the Beast tries her even more with his repeated self-deprecating remarks, Beauty responds emphatically, "Among mankind there are many that deserve the name Beast more than you, and I prefer you just as you are to those who, under a human form, hide a treacherous, corrupt, and ungrateful heart." The sharp contrast between Beauty's goodness and her sister's badness, which is masked by their physical attractiveness, parallels the irony that the Beast, who is repulsive physically, is good and virtuous. Beauty and the Beast teaches the simple but important lesson that appearances can deceive, that what is seen is not always what it appears to be. Similarly, this great fairy tale also bids us to imagine what the outcome might have been had Beauty's sisters been placed in her position. No doubt they would not have recognized or appreciated the goodness beneath the Beast's monstrous appearance. Nor does it seem at all likely that they would have made Beauty's courageous and fortuitous choice. The paradoxical truth that the story portrays is that unless virtue is present in a person, she will not be able to find, appreciate, or embrace virtue in another. Beauty and the Beast embraces one last important moral truth. A person's decisions in life will define what kind of person she becomes. In this sense also, our destinies are not fated, for we decide our own destinies. At the end of the story, the beautiful lady who has visited Beauty in her dreams appears at the Beast's castle and brings with her Beauty's entire family. The fairy then says to Beauty, "Beauty, come and receive the reward of your judicious choice. You have preferred virtue before either wit or beauty, and deserve to have a person in whom these qualifications are united. You are going to be a great queen." Beauty's sisters, however, are unhappy in their marriages because they chose their spouses solely on the basis of good looks and wit. Through greed, jealousy, and pride, their hearts have become like stone. So they are turned into statues but retain their consciousness, that they might behold their sisters' happiness and be moved to admit their own faults. Awakening the Moral Imagination and Teaching the Virtues. Like all great fairy tales, Beauty and the Beast invites us to draw analogies between its imaginary world and the world in which we live. It provides the imagination with information that the self may use to distinguish what is true from what is not. But how, we might ask, is the imagination itself awakened, and how is it made moral? These are important questions for the moral educator, and they are not so easily answered. Buber's frank discussion of the mistakes he made when he first taught ethics helps us to see how difficult awakening and nurturing the moral imagination can be. Buber's mistakes are not uncommon. They are often committed, especially when the role of reason in human conduct is overestimated and the roles of the will and the imagination are underestimated. This hazard is increased by a utilitarian and instrumentalist ethos that has seeped to the taproots of our culture. Despite evidence that we are failing to transmit morality effectively to our children, we persist in teaching ethics as if it comes from a how-to manual for successful living. Moral educators routinely introduce moral principles and even the virtues themselves to students as if they are practical instruments for achieving success. When we tell our children that standards of social utility and material success are the measurements of the value of moral principles and virtues, then it is not likely that our pedagogy is going to transform the minds or convert the hearts of young people. As Buber observed in his own classroom, all that we will accomplish is to confirm the despair of the weak, darken the envy of the poor, justify the greed of the rich, embolden the deceitfulness of the liar, and encourage the aggression of the strong. Much of what passes for moral education fails to nurture the moral imagination. Yet only a pedagogy that awakens and enlivens the moral imagination will persuade the child or the student that courage is the ultimate test of good character, that honesty is essential for trust and harmony among persons, and that humility and a magnanimous spirit are goods greater than the prizes gained by selfishness, pride, or the unscrupulous exercise of position and power. The moral imagination is not a thing, not even so much a faculty of the mind, but rather the very process by which the self makes metaphors out of the images that memory supplies. It then employs these metaphors to suppose correspondences in experience and to make moral judgments. The 20th century philosopher George Santayana explains this process with his own use of metaphor. Perceptions fall into the brain rather as seeds into a furrowed field, or even as sparks into a keg of powder. Each image, in turn, gives birth to more images, sometimes slowly and subterraneously, sometimes when a passionate train is started, with a sudden burst of fancy. The important question is not so much whether imagination is waxing or waning in youth today. For wherever there are human beings, imagination exists and is exercised, much as wherever there are spiders, webs are spun. The important question is what kinds of imagination our contemporary culture is engendering. There are other undesirable forms of imagination, such as the idyllic, the idolatrous, and the diabolic. And these unhealthy forms of imagination are on the rise in a culture dominated by a pervasive media and ubiquitous advertising. We needn't be concerned that spiders will cease spinning their webs properly. Spiders act by instinct. Human beings, however, exercise their imaginations freely. Indeed, it is every bit as correct to say that human beings are imaginative creatures as to say they are reasoning ones. The moral imagination is active for well or ill, strongly or weakly, every moment we are living, whether we are awake or asleep. Yet it needs proper nurture and proper exercise. Otherwise, the moral imagination will atrophy like a muscle that is not used. Furthermore, the richness or poverty of the moral imagination is dependent upon the richness or poverty of experience. When human beings are young and dependent upon parents and others who assume custodial care for them, they are especially open to formation through experiences that these adults may provide. When we argue or discuss what kind of education or recreation our children should have, we are acknowledging these realities. Sadly, too often our society fails to provide children with the kinds of experiences that cultivate and build up the moral imagination. A measure of the impoverishment of the moral imagination in the rising generation is their difficulty in recognizing, making, or using metaphors that will enable them to act responsibly and morally. College students today do not lack an awareness of morality, although they often are confused or puzzled about its basis or their personal ownership of it. Nevertheless, I have found that many are perplexed when reading a novel or a short story because they have not learned how to find and follow the inner connections of character and action, the narrative itself, and the moral meaning that is communicated. This is a failure of imagination, not of knowledge that can be tested. Some years ago, I administered a surprise quiz in a course on theology and literature in which I asked the students to list and explain 5 metaphors that they had found in John Updike's Rabbit Run. The majority of the class could not identify 5 metaphors. Some did not even identify the metaphor in the book's title, which I had purposely discussed as such in a previous class meeting. It was not that these young people lacked a practical definition of a metaphor. They had been provided with the definition in their English courses. They lacked, however, a personal knowledge of metaphor that an active imagination provides. I suspect that in the past these students had gotten the idea that all they needed to do was look for the so-called facts in a book. Facts are things whose meaning belongs to their use and whose use requires relatively little interpretation. We are living in a culture in which metaphor is discarded for these so-called facts. We train minds to detect these facts much as one breaks in a baseball glove. Meanwhile, the moral imagination suffers. Nature, imagination, and poesis. George MacDonald, that great storyteller of the Victorian era, was of the persuasion that an acquaintance with nature may be even more important than story for the formation of the moral imagination. This point was brought home to me more than 2 decades ago when I was teaching at Loyola College of Maryland. I had assigned in my ethics course the 20th century American writer Walker Percy's novel, The Thanatos Syndrome. The protagonist of the novel is a psychiatrist whose name is Thomas Moore. Moore has a theory about human types that he, as the first-person narrator, reveals to the reader at the start of the novel. Moore places all of his patients into one of 2 categories. They are either bluebirds or blue jays. During a classroom discussion of the novel, it dawned upon me that Moore's classificatory metaphors had escaped my students' comprehension. So I raised these questions. Have you observed these birds in nature? And are you at all familiar with the distinctive habits and temperaments of bluebirds and blue jays? Perhaps, for starters, you could identify for me the physical attributes of each bird. My students had a difficult time with this, for they lacked habits of observation and poesis. Poesis is an activity of making that is imaginative. It is the earmark of play itself, which seems to come naturally to young children, not so easily to college-age youth. I can only guess that the young men and women in my classroom had spent far too much time looking at a screen and not out the window, or better still, spending time out of doors. MacDonald urged that even the youngest children be encouraged to observe nature closely in order to put the world together and to speculate from what they see to what they do not see. This sort of attentiveness to nature differs from the empirical method of the natural sciences. It is not so much an activity of reason as of the imagination. It enables not the prediction of phenomena, as science strives to achieve, but rather the invention of literature and poetry, and an appreciation of the same. MacDonald maintains that we assimilate the natural world through our imagination, and also uncover in it an inexhaustible treasure house of forms and images. He cites Thomas Carlyle in Past and Present. The coldest word was once a glowing new metaphor and bold, questionable originality. Thy very attention, does it not mean an attentio, a stretching to? MacDonald adds, all that moves in the mind is symbolized in nature. Or, to use another more philosophical and certainly not less poetic figure, the world is a sensuous analysis of humanity. Take any word expressive of emotion, take the word emotion itself, and you will find that its primary meaning is of the outer world, as the rustling and agitation of the trees is analogized to the self in its inner disturbances. In other words, that which is outside of us is the necessary precondition for understanding ourselves inwardly. And when we put into words this experience of the external world with its forms and images and relate that to our inner experience, our humanity in all its depth and complexity of meaning flowers and is unveiled. The imagination lights the way. The very essence of things and the world in its wholeness are revealed to us along with our relationship to that world. What would we do without the lion to remind us of the nobility that belongs to our nature, or the owl for the wisdom into which we must mature as human beings? What fairy tales do for the moral imagination? Fairy tales and fantasy stories transport the reader into other worlds that are fresh with wonder, surprise, and danger. They challenge the reader to make sense out of those other worlds, to navigate his or her way through them, and to imagine oneself in the place of the heroes and heroines who populate those worlds. The safety and assurance of these imaginative adventures is that risks may be taken without having to endure all of the consequences of failure. The joy is in discovering how these risky adventures might eventuate in satisfactory and happy outcomes. Yet the concept of self is also transformed. The images and metaphors in these stories stay with the reader, even after he has returned to the real world. After a child has read Hans Christian Andersen's The Snow Queen, or C.S. Lewis's The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, her moral imagination is bound to have been stimulated and sharpened. These stories offer powerful images of good and evil and show her how to love through the examples of the characters she has come to love and admire. This will spur her imagination to translate these experiences and images into the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.